You know that feeling when you postpone something for just 2 days, just two, because you want to relax, and you just check back after and it's already December. Alright, I'm Dr. E and I'll be talking to you about the history of Nigeria. But when I was making this research, I thought it was going to be fun, honestly. Reading books, uncovering interesting details and all that jazz, but I was wrong. And a bit retarded. There's so much stuff to cover and rushing into sound really. So I'll be stripping this big video for parts and spreading it over the span of three videos also. The pre-colonial era, as you can tell by the title of this video, the colonial era and the early post-colonial era. Now I'll say this straight up that in the early years, Africans, further south, Nigerians included, weren't the type to keep a journal of history or any kind of journal because, I don't know, their process involved simple human activities like hunting and gathering, preferring to pass on their history and culture by spoken words of mouth. And our modern day archaeologists in Nigeria are too busy with forex to bother about going into some shady cave to look for bones or drawing that some people made a few centuries ago. So there's little to know yet. But humans have been existing here for about 3,000 years or so. The earliest culture found was in Kaduna, and it was in Nok by their distinctive iron artifacts a guy found digging in his backyard or something. And because of the Nok smelting skill, there was a trade link established between Niger and the South around the beginning of the second millennium AD, with my northern boys acting as middlemen. Later, iron smelting business was booming. They sold a lot of swords, clothes. Fast forward a couple of millennia and a wave of migrating bodies later, Yoruba and Edo kingdoms sprung up on the west. Politics happened. A lot of monarch fights, betrayal, and Portugal, which we'll cover in a separate video, saw them separate into their own independent states. In the east, the Uri people, which the Igbo people happened to be a part of, was there also making bronze artifacts and slaughtering twins. Yeah, they practiced sort of a socio-political system of government. So even though they were decentralized, they still had to follow the government, and it means anything their kings or Obi or supreme leader says, it's basically the truth and the gospel. Man, it's almost as if Nigerians can't resist making bad decisions on the fly when politics enter the chat. Over up north, my guys were busy chasing the bag, buying and selling stuff through trade routes and links they created earlier. And through those trade links, that's where the Islamic religion came in. The north formed sort of an alliance with the strongest of these Islamic dynastic kingdoms, including Gao, Kanem, and Ghana, which is kind of weird because Ghana is not close to the northern states, but they did play a major role in shaping them. In the 11th century, Ghana declined due to inferior jollof rice, and Mali took over as the strongest kingdom. Songhai emerged from Gao and dominated everyone for a while. For a century, Gao paid homage to Mali, but by the last decade of the 15th century, it attained its independence and brought Malian's domains under its imperial sway. Although these Western empires had little political influence on the savanna states of Nigeria before 1500, they had a strong cultural and economic impact that became more pronounced in the 16th century, especially because these states became associated with the spread of Islam and trade. So, in the 16th century, moreover, much of the northern Nigeria paid homage to Songhai in the west or to Borno, a rival empire in the east, because Islam, Fulbe Pastoralists, I hope I pronounced that correctly, known in Nigeria as Fulani, began to enter the Hausa country in the 13th century, and by the 15th century, they were tending cattle, sheep, and goats in Borno as well. The Fulani came from the Senegal River Valley, where their ancestors had developed a method of livestock management and specialization based on transhumance. The movement of cattle along north-south corridors in pursuit of grazing and water followed the climatic pattern of rain and dry season. Gradually, pastoralists moved eastwards, first into the centers of Mali and Songhai Empire, and eventually into Hausaland and Borno. This is what basically happened before the colonial era, and just kind of set the ground stage of what was about to happen next. There were lots of side stories here and there, which Mr. E would elaborate on in later videos. So, yeah, that's pretty much it. Please subscribe and please just watch the next video. We'll be releasing from a day to a week from now. So, subscribe and like, please.